Hello everyone, today we are here to understand the peritoneal reflections and the peritoneal cavity. So the peritoneum is the largest serous membrane or sac which lines the abdominal cavity and a lot of the viscera within it. So it is kind of a similar to what we have seen in the thorax, that is the pleura in the serous pericardium. Serous membrane is the sac which produces the serous fluid. So right now we are looking at the abdomen, from the front. So after removing the anterior abdominal wall and its muscles, we are now looking at the abdominal organs from the front. Before entering into understanding the peritoneum, first let us understand the general disposition of all the abdominal organs. So this broad sheet, what you see here, which covers a variable extent of the small intestine, this is known as greater omentum, right? This is known as greater omentum. Here you can see the greater curvature of the stomach. This is the greater curvature of the stomach, and this is attached to the greater curvature, that is our greater omentum. This entire is the stomach. When I reflect the stomach upwards, this is the transverse colon. This is transverse colon. So you can see that the greater omentum is reflected to the transverse colon, right? So greater omentum is connecting the stomach with the transverse colon. These are the coils of small intestine. This everything is intestine, small intestine, right? These are small intestine. On this side, you can see this is the ascending colon. Here we can see the cecum. This is cecum. This is appendix. On the left side, this is the descending colon. This is the left colic flexure. On right side, this is the right colic flexure. We are looking here at the sagittal section, which I have just described to you in C2. So we have got the liver at the top, then we have the stomach, then pancreas behind the stomach and other organs, that is the duodenum. Here we can see the transverse colon. Sorry, this is the transverse colon. This is small gut. This is sigmoid colon. Here beneath we have got the rectum, and here we have urinary bladder. So peritoneum is the membrane which surrounds the abdominal wall and the abdominal organs, right? So the part here, you can see the part which covers the abdominal wall, right? This one, this is known as the parietal peritoneum, and the peritoneum which covers the viscera. For example, here we can see the transverse colon. So the part of the viscera which covers the organs, abdominal organs, this viscera, we will name it as visceral peritoneum. Similarly, here you can see that this part of the peritoneum which is covering the stomach, here we can see the liver, right? This is the visceral peritoneum. Now here, what is important for you to remember, that parietal peritoneum and visceral peritoneum, they are not separate membranes. They are a continuous sheet, right? And they are not separate things. If you see here, this peritoneum, that is the parietal peritoneum, we can extend it up to the diaphragm. So here there is diaphragm. So here at the diaphragm, it is reflected upon itself, and now when it is covering the liver, that is the abdominal organ, we will name it as visceral peritoneum. So the continuity can be traced up to the diaphragm, right? Here also you can see that this is the parietal peritoneum. It is reflected over the liver, and then we will call it as visceral peritoneum. So this is the parietal peritoneum, and we have understood the visceral peritoneum. So between these two layers, the space which we can see, this all space which we can see, this is the peritoneal cavity, right? This is known as peritoneal cavity, and it contains peritoneal fluid. This peritoneal fluid, which is contained in the peritoneal cavity, it helps to lubricate the movements and expansion of the gut. Also, what other thing do we note here? At certain places, we can see some double folds. For example, here, right? Here, what is happening? This is a double layer fold, but this is only visceral peritoneum. So, what happens when this peritoneum, visceral peritoneum, is reflected from liver to the stomach? For example, here, it is reflected here, and this layer is also reflected. So, there is a doubling of the visceral peritoneum. Between the stomach and the other organs, this doubling up of the visceral peritoneum is given a special name, which is known as omenta. Now, if it is connecting the stomach with the liver, we will name this doubling of the visceral peritoneum as lesser omentum. And if the stomach is connected to the transverse colon, this doubling of the visceral peritoneum is known as greater omentum. When this doubling is at the small gut, right, or the transverse colon, you can see that this doubling is suspending the transverse colon to the posterior abdominal wall. And this doubling, which is suspending the transverse colon, is known as transverse mesocolon. Similarly, if it is suspending the small gut to the posterior abdominal wall, we will call it mesentery. And if it is suspending the sigmoid colon to the posterior abdominal wall, it is known as sigmoid mesocolon. Also, it is important to understand the difference between retroperitoneal and intraperitoneal organs. Intraperitoneal organs are those organs which are almost fully covered by visceral peritoneum. That is, they are covered by the doubling up of the visceral peritoneum. But truly, there are no organs which are fully covered by visceral peritoneum. So, intraperitoneal organs, for example, here we can see the stomach. They are covered by visceral peritoneum on both the sides, and they are suspended by these folds of visceral peritoneum into the peritoneal cavity. Retroperitoneal organs are those organs which lie behind the peritoneum. So this is the line of reflection of peritoneum, and behind this line of reflection we can see one organ, that is pancreas. So pancreas is one of the retroperitoneal organs. So now we can divide the entire peritoneal cavity into greater sac. This entire is the greater sac, and the part of the peritoneal cavity which is present behind the lesser omentum and the stomach, this is known as the lesser sac, or we can also call this much portion as omental bursa. So this is known as omental bursa or lesser sac, the part of the peritoneal cavity present behind the stomach, lesser omentum, and here there is a caudate lobe of liver. So behind this structure there is a large recess. This is known as lesser sac. Greater sac and lesser sac, they are communicating with each other through one foramen which is present here, which is known as epiploic foramen. Epiploic foramen. So let us first start with the vertical disposition of the peritoneum. For understanding the vertical disposition, we will start from the umbilicus. So if I reflect this anterior abdominal wall, here this peritoneum which you see, which is lining the abdominal wall, this is the parietal peritoneum. The parietal peritoneum lining the abdominal wall, that starts, we are starting from the umbilicus. So here it is forming a double layer fold, sickle shaped fold, which is known as falciform ligament. This sickle shaped fold, it is attached slightly right to the midline, and it is giving one posterior free margin. Now this is cut like this, so we are going to reflect the wall, and rest of the falciform ligament we will see in the liver. So you can see that this is a broad double layer sickle shaped fold which is having a posterior free margin, which is known as falciform ligament. This falciform ligament, when traced upwards, it is attached to the junction of anatomically right and left lobe of the liver. This is the inferior border of liver, so it is attached at the junction. Now this falciform ligament in the posterior free border, it contains ligamentum teres and paraumbilical vein. The parietal peritoneum, which is lining the anterior abdominal wall, which we have seen, that is reflected from the diaphragm onto the liver, right? So the peritoneum, which is reflected from the diaphragm to the liver, now here it is becoming the visceral peritoneum. This layer, that is the superior layer of coronary ligament, it will be continuous with the right layer of falciform ligament. Rest of the superior layer of coronary ligament will cover the anterior surface, superior surface, sharp inferior border of the liver, and then it will swipe posteriorly. Posteriorly, it will meet with the inferior layer of coronary ligament and it will unite at the lateral end to form the right triangular ligament here. The inferior layer of the coronary ligament from the liver, it will be reflected over the second part of the duodenum, right colic flexure, and posteriorly over the anterior surface of the right kidney. As the kidney is retroperitoneal, we are not able to see the kidney here, but we can see the visceral peritoneum. This is known as the hepatorenal pouch of Morrison. From the anterior surface of the right kidney, the rest of the peritoneum, it will sweep down and go and cover the anterior and sides of the ascending colon. So this gutter which is formed here, this is the right paracolic gutter. It will go down and it will form a fold for the appendix. This is appendix. So this fold is known as mesoappendix. Rest of the peritoneum will cover the respective parts of the liver here. Left layer of the falciform ligament, that is continuous with the anterior surface of the left triangular ligament. So this fold, this shining fold which you see between the left lobe and the diaphragm, this is our left triangular ligament. At the porta hepatis, it will form right from the anterior lip of the porta hepatis, the rest of the peritoneum will sweep downwards and it will form the anterior layer of lesser omentum. This layer which you see between the liver and the stomach, this entire is stomach and this is the lesser curvature of stomach. So from the anterior lip of porta hepatis, the peritoneum, it will sweep down and form the anterior layer of lesser omentum. Then it will go down and it will cover the anterosuperior surface of stomach. It will move further and it forms the first layer of greater omentum. It will fold upon itself and form the fourth layer of greater omentum. Now, as we have already seen that just behind the stomach, we have transverse colon. So this fourth layer of greater omentum, it will go and attach at the transverse colon. After covering the transverse colon, it will go forwards and will form the transverse mesocolon and will attach the transverse colon to the posterior abdominal wall. These are the coils of small intestine. The coils of small intestine, they are suspended by a double layer fold which is known as the mesentery. So here if you see, this is the fold that is suspending the small gut and this is known as mesentery. Now if I reflect all the coils of small intestine towards the right side, we can see the attachment of the root of the mesentery extending from the left side to the right side, starting from duodeno-jejunal flexure, you can see here, to the right sacroiliac joint, right? Up to here. So we can very nicely see the root of mesentery. This peritoneum which we have seen on towards the right side forming the right paracolic gutter, right? It will go and cover the ascending colon and the sides. And here, for a better understanding and better view, the coils of the small intestine are removed. But if you remember, we have already seen the mesentery and the two layers. So this layer which is covering the ascending colon will go and form the right layer of the mesentery, will go and cover the coils of the small intestine, will form the left layer of mesentery, and then it will continue towards the left to cover the descending colon, sides of the descending colon. Then on the side it will form the left paracolic gutter, and from here it will continue with the parietal peritoneum of the anterior abdominal wall. From the left paracolic gutter, it will sweep down, go towards the pelvic cavity, will form the sigmoid mesocolon, If you know the attachment of the root of sigmoid mesocolon, it is in the form of inverted V shape. The root is attached at the left sacroiliac joint. The left limb, it accompanies the left pelvic bream. The right limb that extends from the left sacroiliac joint to the middle of the third sacral vertebra. Right? So this is the attachment of root of sigmoid mesocolon. From the sigmoid mesocolon, it will still sweep and go and cover the organs of the pelvic cavity. If it is male, then anteriorly bladder, urinary bladder and posteriorly rectum. And if it is female, in between we will have uterus, and it will cover the respective surfaces of the pelvic organs. Now from the apex of the urinary bladder, here you can see a continuity. A median fold is formed here. This is the median umbilical fold, which contains median umbilical ligament. Lateral to the median umbilical fold, there is medial umbilical fold, which contains obliterated umbilical arteries, and lateral to it, there is lateral umbilical fold, which contains the which overlaps inferior epigastric arteries. From here, it will continue with the parietal peritoneum of the anterior abdominal wall. When this anterior layer of the lesser omentum, it is covering the anterosuperior surface of the stomach, here we can see the spleen. So what will happen? The peritoneum, which is covering the anterosuperior surface of stomach, near the fundus of the stomach, this peritoneum will sweep towards the left, and this ligament which you see here, that is known as gastrosplenic ligament. So this peritoneum will form the anterior layer of gastrosplenic ligament. It will cover the entire spleen. Then it will swipe posteriorly and it will form the posterior layer of leno-renal ligament. Another fold which has to be seen here, that is connecting the left colic flexure to the undersurface of the diaphragm. You can see a fold here which is known as phrenico-colic ligament. It also supports the anterior end of the spleen. That is why this ligament is also known as sustentaculum linis. From the posterior lip of the pota hepatis, this is the anterior layer. From the anterior lip of pota hepatis, from the posterior lip of pota hepatis, the peritoneum will sweep down and form the posterior layer of lesser omentum, will cover the posterior inferior surface of stomach posteriorly. Here we have seen that this is forming the first layer, right? Similarly, inside, so here we have already cut, so you can see the posterior inferior surface, right? So it will continue down and form the second layer of greater omentum, will sweep again upward and form the third layer. From there, it will go and cover the transverse colon, and posteriorly it is bound to the anterior border of pancreas. Again, pancreas is a retroperitoneal organ, so we are not able to see here very nicely, but that is also forming the lesser sac, right? So this entire recess which is seen here behind the stomach, this is our lesser sac. This is the lesser omentum, right? This we have seen. So if I put my fingers here, right, this becomes the right free margin of the lesser omentum. So this is the anterior layer of lesser omentum. Towards the right side, the anterior layer is going posteriorly and it is continuous with the posterior layer of lesser omentum. Accidentally, this right free margin, it is also forming the anterior boundary of epiploic foramen. So that is a broad understanding of the vertical disposition of peritoneum. As you have already known by now that peritoneum is a double layered bag. Now it is a bag, means it is like a balloon. So whatever abdominal organs are coming in its way, it will go and cover the respective surfaces. So if there is liver, then it will cover certain surfaces of the liver, then it will go to stomach, then transverse colon on the two sides, large intestine, ascending and descending colon, mesentery and respective organs of the pelvic cavity. So it is very, very important to understand the general disposition of the organs also. Now, as we have seen the disposition of the peritoneum in situ, let us quickly revise it again in this diagram. This is the sagittal section.
So we will start with the umbilicus somewhere here. From the umbilicus, the parietal peritoneum lining the anterior abdominal wall, it is reflected onto the diaphragm. From the diaphragm, this is again reflected as the visceral peritoneum over the liver, forming the corresponding ligaments that we have already seen, that is the superior inferior layer of coronary ligament, right and left triangular ligaments on the respective sides. From all the parts of the liver, the two layers, they are reflected upon stomach as the lesser omentum, the anterior layer and posterior layer. Anterior layer of the lesser omentum sweeps down, covers the anterosuperior surface of stomach, continues down as the first layer of greater omentum. Posterior layer of lesser omentum that goes down and covers the posterior inferior surface of stomach continues down as the second layer. First layer will fold upon itself to continue as the fourth layer, and second layer will fold upon itself to continue as the third layer. Now from here onwards, the course of second and third layer are different. The third layer, after covering the transverse colon, it moves upwards posteriorly to cover the structures in the upper part of the posterior abdominal wall. The fourth layer, after covering the transverse colon, will move further, will form transverse mesocolon. Along the pancreas, it is reflected down. It continues to cover the small gut, forms the mesentery, goes down to form the sigmoid mesocolon, and then covering the structures of the posterior abdominal wall, it will sweep into the pelvic cavity. Now here what we are seeing, this is the sagittal section of male. So this peritoneum that will move down and it will cover the rectum. From the anterior surface of the rectum, it is reflected upon the superior surface of the urinary bladder. So in case of males, we have formation of this pouch, which is known as rectovesical pouch, right? Rectovesical pouch.
In case of females, you can see that it passes in front of the rectum to the uterus, forming the rectouterine pouch, and from the uterus to the urinary bladder, forming the vesicouterine pouch. Both in male and female, the peritoneum passes from the urinary bladder to the anterior abdominal wall, right, thus completing the sagittal tracing of the peritoneum. So we have started from umbilicus, we have gone upwards towards the diaphragm, from the liver, stomach, transverse colon, pancreas, then we have gone to small intestine, sigmoid colon, the organs of the pelvic cavity, and then from the superior surface of the urinary bladder, this continues with the we have also seen the folds which are formed in the posterior part of the anterior abdominal wall, and then it is continuing with the parietal peritoneum lining the abdominal wall. So that completes our entire tracing of the peritoneum. Thank you.